So this daguerreotype of Frederick Douglass has been unveiled today. It's on loan from the Chester County Historical Society in Pennsylvania, and it's a really wonderful connection between our Frederick Douglass collection and our Susan B. Anthony collection, because of course Frederick Douglass gave this daguerreotype of himself to Susan B. Anthony. There's some evidence to suggest that it would have been on display in her home. And again, that's another really great clue into the significance of their relationship. I can imagine entering Susan B. Anthony's house in the 19th century and seeing this photograph of Frederick Douglass potentially on her mantelpiece or in her living room. And that would have told me just how close they were, and it would have given me a sense of kind of the local connections to the abolitionist and suffrage movements.
This is a silver peak.
That's right, and a bit of sodium.
We have been studying the nanoscience and the conservation science of the daguerreotype here at the University of Rochester for about 5 or 6 years. So this involves things like electron microscopy, which allows us to look at the daguerreotype at a magnification and with a sensitivity in terms of its metallic composition that's just unprecedented. What's especially interesting to us is that it tells us about the daguerreotype as an individual object. That's to say, the nanoscience, the material science, that structure differs from daguerreotypist to daguerreotypist, because just like a chef, each daguerreotypist had a particular recipe and a particular way of doing things. So as we do the analysis of this daguerreotype of Frederick Douglass, what we hope to do is to create an entry into the catalog of the details of this daguerreotype. And what's remarkable is that this daguerreotype is not completely attributed yet. We really don't know who made it or where. So as we begin this particular study, we'll try to get other daguerreotypists from the New York City area, from Rochester, from Westchester, Pennsylvania. We'll do similar studies for them and see if they show the same traits. Because understanding who made this daguerreotype contributes to the humanistic record and the story of Frederick Douglass.
There are only 9 surviving daguerreotypes of him. A lot of the photographs that we see that are here in our collection at the University of Rochester are from him as an older man. And I think that by having this item on view in particular, it gives researchers, students, our university community a great sense of what he looked like as a younger person when he was just getting started in his career as a lecturer and as an abolitionist.
Almost every daguerreotype that we've looked at has biological life or had biological life existing on it. Small fungi that were living on the surface that were in fact metabolizing some of the metals. Understanding what the daguerreotype looks like on the nanoscale, both in terms of what it looks like on its surface, but also what it looks like under its surface, gives us clues as to what we need to do to conserve it.
So I think one of the great things about having this item on display is just that it's of course going to support the research of faculty here at the university, but it also gives us an opportunity to ask more questions. And that's one of the real benefits of working and being a part of a special collections department, that we have those opportunities to ask questions and to work with scholars to start to learn more about our own human history.
A production of the University of Rochester. Please visit us online and subscribe to our channel for more videos.